Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the third edition of the BK Talks at the Faculty of Architecture and the Built Environment of the Technical University of Delft. I'm very pleased to introduce you to the third of the sessions. After having spoken about inclusivity and circularity, today we are going to talk about one of the subjects that matters the most at the university, which is education. Education, the challenges of education, or the future of education. One of the things that I was most interested about doing when we started this adventure of the VK Talks with Dean Dick van Hameren was to actually bring as many people together from different departments of the faculty. So this is what we have here tonight with us. I am extremely happy to be to have gathered several of our professors from different departments, from architecture, not only architecture, which is the big one maybe, but there are many others. So it is especially touching for me also to have behind me some authors which I have always admired a lot. Tonight, the panel will be moderated by the Dean of the Faculty, Dick van Hameren, and we have invited as professors Rinks Dijkstra, excuse my bad pronunciation, Carola Hein, Kees Kahn, Vinnie Maas, Anna Pereira Rhodes, and Sevil Sarilidis. I'm going to give the word to the moderator, Dick, tonight. And please, the floor is yours. Thank you very much for joining us. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Javier. For me, this is really a very nice moment in time. I think already for years we had this exchange between the professors that it would be good to have more public debates amongst ourselves, but somehow it was always very difficult to organize that. And I think you did a great job by indeed bringing all these professors together. So I'm really looking forward to an interesting debate, or in Dutch, een goed gesprek tonight. And the idea is that this evening consists of two parts. We will start with brief presentations of the six professors. We all gave them 5 minutes, so maybe at some point I have to intervene. If you're talking already for more than half an hour, I really have to stop you. And then in the second half, of course, we will have a conversation, a discussion. And I'm also happy to see some students in these strange times on the orange grandstand. So I hope you will be involved in the discussion as well, because in the end, it's also about you. It's a discussion about the future of education in the Faculty of Architecture and the built environment. So I hope we will learn how our professors think about this future. It's of course about what are we teaching and how are we teaching. And just to start, I have two images. And sometimes I think maybe nothing changes in architectural education. This is one of my favorite images. It's from the 1920s. It's a famous Czech architect, Pavel Janák, who's standing here with students, and of course he is reviewing their models. And maybe that's the essence of architectural education, and why would it change? And another thing that I think is of course very important of architectural education is seeing reality with your own eyes. And this is also Professor Janák, who's traveling with his students to Amsterdam in 1924 to see what was happening in this country. Well, that's looking back, but tonight we're looking to the future, and I think we have six professors here who will take us into their future. And we start with Rinks Dijkstra. The floor is yours. I think you have your own, we all have our own equipment. You use the other clicker, because this one has been... infected by me.
I think you are in a privileged position, because usually you'd sit here with 200 people, and now there's only, if I don't count them in, there's only 9 of you, so this is your chance to have a big impact on the debate, more than ever. Maybe I should note a couple of things. I'm not a professor. I used to be a professor, but I asked for a demotion because the professorship asked things of me that I didn't feel comfortable with. And I have been given the chance, a generous opportunity by the Department of Urbanism to focus solely on design education. And it consists of two parts. I teach and I think about how to teach better. Another thing to know is that I'm firmly rooted in practice. You could say I'm a part-timer. Half of my time is dedicated to Delft, and the other half is working as an urbanist in my practice post at Max One. 5 minutes is ridiculously short to say meaningful things about the future of design education. And what I did is I just sat down and I just threw out some, I grabbed every first thought that I had and put it on paper, and then I stopped after 6 sentences because I only got 5 minutes. And some of these are deep felt thoughts that have emerged from being a designer for 30 years, and some of them are based on recent meetings, books, frustrations, or encounters with students from the Department of Urbanism, some of them graduation from graduate students from outside, for instance, a teaching that I do with a student from a CITG. So I'll start and just list them up and give some small remarks. There's a special situation that needs to be understood for Bouwkunde, Faculty of Architecture and Built Environment in Delft University. I see many universities fall victim to a kind of Anglo-Saxon model of scientific research that I think we should guard ourselves against. So what would be ideal would be a lockdown of this university against all the scientific and pseudo-scientific method that is trying to pry their way indoors. Another way to say, the more friendly way is to say there's a spatial design and the scientific method are an uneasy marriage. Spatial design, I think, by default cannot be scientific. The example I always give is, for instance, in urban design, if you ask an ecologist how to do the street, he points that way. If you ask the traffic designer, they point that way. There is no overlap between the two, which is scientifically right. We have to moderate. So this uneasy marriage needs counseling. That's the task that Dick has. He has to counsel, and I think you are the right man for the task. And I think you will easily find support in the rooms of this faculty to help you do that counseling. I don't know why I wrote this down, but maybe because it leads to the next slide. There's a known statistic that the quality of the reading and the amount of time spent reading, and therefore also the quality of writing, especially in Holland, but I don't think it's only Holland. Holland has a very bad track record among countries in Europe. The quality of our education on reading and writing, and the quality of our reading and writing being taught from homes, let's say, is dwindling fast. Fewer time, fewer interest, worse and worse texts and grammar. At the same time, the amount of text-based reporting is growing kind of very fast in exactly the other direction. You can do the math yourself, what that leads to. The link with the next sentence is that I plead for a design education that relies heavily on the visual. I'm asking my students more and more, don't write, write less. If you think you should write something next to this drawing or next to this diagram, your drawing or diagram is not good enough. Try to do everything visual. The most important part of the visual output is the sketch. And the next one could be the diagram, the plan, and then all the 3D stuff. What you want to visualize is the fact that we're dealing as architects and as urbanists with enormous amounts of conflicting data and that we have to make them accessible. I think making the complexity and the enormous amounts of data, growing amounts of data accessible is the key to becoming a successful designer. Design cannot be taught in 5 years alongside all the other teaching. There's simply not enough time, not enough face-to-face contact, not enough examples, not enough deep exchange between students and people who have gotten somewhere in having an overview of design. That's why we need to focus. We need to select our topic and we need to select our approach. And my after being a teacher for 25 years, my heartfelt feeling is that we have to focus on a basic teaching at university. We have to focus on a basic skill set and a basic method. The skill set, the method part of the sentence is dropped away, but I know it by heart. The skill set would, my preferred quick listing would be how to do analysis fast, focus on the visual, focus on the digital, I will say something to that on my last slide, and focus on presentation. As a basic method, I'm a strong proponent of what is can be summarized as the Dutch method. Dick and I have quite some discussions about it. I also had quite some debates about it when transitioning from being a professor to being a design fellow, which is my title now. I think there's something special about the approach to design which is practiced in Holland. It has a tradition. The tradition is long and many changes have been made, refinements to the tradition to make it work in current times. Vinnie and I have seen marvelous aspects of that tradition when we worked at REM. I think we both have taken many aspects of that approach, Kohlhaas, and practice it in our own offices. It's something that I want to extend and make more prominent and speak about more openly in my work here at Delft. And the last two loose remarks are, one, wouldn't it be a good idea to look at the Design Academy in Eindhoven as an example of a teaching model, not one to copy, but one to learn a couple of things from? I have a son studying there, and I'm delighted about what I see that they make him do and how they teach. And I think some of that might have been here in Delft as well, but some of it also has been lost. So that's something that I have now some experience with, and we could have a look at it. One thing, maybe all of these things have nothing to do with design teaching in the future, they have to do with design teaching, which I think is more or less one of the same thing. I think design thinking has been the same in essence and will be the same in essence 100 years back and 100 years into the future. There's no fundamental change required. The one big exception is the transition from let's say handwork. So for architects and urbanists, you might say sketching and modeling, towards using digital methods. There's no way that sketching is going to survive. You can see the curve of how people spend their time with different media over the last 10 or 20 years. You can see the change happening. So we have to figure out a way of making sketching work purely digitally, and in that transfer from hand to digital, keep some of the vital aspects of the hand sketch and the hand model. That's it. Thank you.
So the order of the speakers is strictly alphabetical on the surname, so there's nothing intended there than just that. So our next speaker is Carola.
Dick, is this on? Yes. Thanks a lot, Dick, for organizing this. I think it's a great opportunity for all of us to actually engage with these questions and to come together. I probably need the clicker at some point, yes. So what I would I should have said I'm in the chair, History of Architecture and Urban Planning, so you can probably expect me to come into this debate with a long-term view. But as Dick said, we're looking into the future, but I think in order to look into the future, you also have to look into the past. And what I would like to do here is to argue for the need to bring space, society, and culture together. And if we are, and we are currently at a moment where we need to engage with global urgencies, transitions, I think we need to think about paradigm shifts, transition strategies, and that requires critical thinking. So the three things that I would like to point out is that we need long-term perspectives, multi-scalar thinking, and multidisciplinary interventions. And what do I mean with that? So when I say long-term perspectives, we need to think where we stand, why we stand, and how we got there. And even the way in which you think is based on the culture that you grew up in, the spaces that you experienced. And unless you're aware of that, it's very difficult to go beyond it. So we need to challenge our imaginaries. And for example, here in Holland, just think about the milkmaid that some of you may have grown up with and realize that we are in an area that is the second biggest petroleum hub after Houston, when you take the Amsterdam, Rotterdam, Antwerpen area together. So I really understand and I like the plea from Reens for more visuals, and I think these are the kinds of visuals that can challenge our narratives and the narratives and the stories that we've grown up with. And many of you are in the field of architecture and making visuals, and these visuals are very prominent. So this is the one text slide I wanted to give you, because we made a little inquiry among our students on the importance of teaching history for design with my colleague Elise van Doren, who passed her PhD today and did a PhD thesis on design education. And interestingly, out of the several hundred of interviews we did, or questionnaires we handed out, I would say 90% of them said history is the root of culture. So I'll send you to the article itself to read it, and I'm not going to read this out. But I think it's very important to position yourself into your time and place. And I think this positioning and understanding of the place, space, culture that you grew up in is also part of design. And that's what I've tried to do in the classes that I teach. We did, for example, a mapping of oil installations in the port of Rotterdam. And you find out that there are particular paradigms that have driven the development of Rotterdam, first as a staple port, then as a transit port. But we still don't know what the paradigm of the future is. What kind of port does Rotterdam want to be? Will we go on shipping via from China? Will it be now the Arctic route? Will it be more containers, less containers? Will we go circular and actually have more production here? Will we bring 3D printing back to the Netherlands? So all of these questions, when you talk about circularity, it's not just a question of space or new technologies, it's really also it's a question of how you imagine society, governance, and the culture of the spaces you live in. So taking that kind of a question, we've been mapping and also starting to use big data on this to try and figure out how do, for example, port cities evolve and how do they shape and change over time. So looking here at Rotterdam, we've done this for Hamburg and London too, you see that there's a particular spatial pattern where in the case of Rotterdam, the port leads and the city follows. It's a very different story in a case like Hamburg, where port and city have developed together or the case of London, where the port private actors buy land outside the city to really escape from the city in one way. Now, if you are in a situation where a port and city have a specific marriage, to get back to that term, you want to know how can you break that up. So if you want to make this area circular, want to shape it, you have to understand what the forces are and why they've come into reality over time. Now, that kind of argument I've been using for the students to understand, on the one hand, long-term developments, but I also said multi-scalar developments. So in one of the courses, this is a project that came out of one of the courses that we did on the Port of Rotterdam. You see many, I think, interesting ideas of spatial analysis. For example, when you study waterscapes, when you study port cities, there are very few people who will think about it as a vertical dimension. And when we critically think about water and space, we have to acknowledge that digging out the rivers, the canals, is one of the things we have to do in the Netherlands, and water rising also means that we have to really think water in on the third dimension, on a vertical dimension. And there are examples now for the architects to think about a vertical cruise ship terminal, which is now being built in Hamburg, for example, or other means of making a port vertical instead of making it horizontal. So there's a big opportunity to think critically, spatially, visionary, and to play with design fiction to make stories of the future. So in these courses, we've asked students to look at what are the actors, what are the stories that could happen in the future? Where would you want to be? What kind of power will be happening? What kind of, who will be driving it, energy, or whatever is the main player? And for example, this was one of the outcomes where the students imagined everything from new places for birds to nest in the port of Rotterdam, to new spaces for green energy, for biomass, etc. I'm not going to go into it. But in this with this background of trying to make design fictions happen, to think about what does it really mean to clean up the lands we have, the port spaces, the oil spaces of the past. Could we have self-driving machines that clean up the soil, plant new seeds, and then come up with new buildings after that? So the idea of designing strategies for the future, of designing transitions, or here also to be very critical about how do we talk about spaces like the port city, the relation between water and land, the viscous spaces between them. I think this requires a critical approach. It requires knowledge about governance, about society, about culture. And it really means that we have to teach, in my opinion, from a very multidisciplinary perspective. And one of the opportunities we have also being in this area is to, the opportunities we have with our students is to really give them creative assignments. And that's what I appreciate, because often when I tell my stories about with a historical perspective, the papers that I get back, because this is one of the results of it, is a game. So a group of students made a game that we presented to the Port of Rotterdam, which they really liked, Harbor Hustle. And they said, go for it, you should be developing this further. So there's all this creative energy that is here, which when it is embedded in a context of critical thinking for transitions, I think it's very powerful. And we're also in an area where we have, like the Leidendelft Erasmus collaboration, we've got really good other institutions around here in Leiden, anthropology, sociology, and all of these disciplines that are often focused on analysis rather than future thinking can become a foundation for what we want to do with design in the future. So that's basically to end with my plea for more multidisciplinary collaboration. Thank you.
Thank you, Carola. Also very well timed. Kees, can I invite you?
Thank you, Dick. Well, good evening. It's good to stand here in front of a few people, but I also want to welcome the students and other people at home that are watching this. I don't know how many we have. Maybe you have a clue about that, how many people are watching the stream. I'm going to make some statements and some throw some ideas for the discussion. It's focused on design education, of course, and I start with saying design education remains vocational. That is a sort of basic condition. We're here to teach a profession. Of course, that profession is changing. This is, of course, a very old-fashioned image of an architect. And we'd like to know how it's changing, of course. We'd like to understand that. But it also remains the same because we're still, in the end, always trying to find results, and results can be found in a construction site. To design requires to comprehend complexity, to really thoroughly understand what we design for and what we design with. This means that we need to learn to unpack and rephrase requirements and rephrase them to our field, rephrase them to the field of architecture and the built environment. And based on that understanding, we can start carefully and simply test propositions. This is an example of unpacking, of course. Of course, we are interested in what's different today and will be even more different tomorrow from what was yesterday. So things stay the same, but also things change. The availability of mass information, of course, today is something that is really different, and this availability is growing exponentially. We're also acquiring new tools to manage this information, including in the future maybe artificial intelligence. But we're also acquiring new tools to visualize this information. This is super important for architects, of course. Irene's already explained that. But our clients and the people for whom we work are also getting more information and are also getting smarter. So they have higher expectations and their requirements becoming more complex. And we have to deal with changing values. But this has always been like that, the last one. Values in society always change. That doesn't mean we can ignore them, but it is a permanent change, you could say. So how does this all impact education and profession? It's not merely about collecting data, but we have to learn how to manage this information. We have to learn how to organize it and to prioritize. We have to learn how to share it and share the knowledge. And that means that our designs are not just designs for a possible future, but our designs are a tool to communicate with each other before they become a model for a possible future. Of course, due to this increasing complexity and availability of information and the necessity to collaborate with other engineers to become multidisciplinary, we work more and more integrated and also concurrent. That means that things happen at the same time in different skills. We don't go from big to small anymore, but we work on all the skills simultaneously. What does it mean for students and teachers? Well, with the students, we try to figure out how to deal with all this. So our studio has become the place for investigation. We don't know. We also sort of overwhelmed by these changes. So we're trying to figure out here in Delft how to deal with this condition. So our education sort of reinvents itself while doing it. We constantly adapt and we change to this condition, and the students help us do that. So basically our teachers that are working with the students, they learn while they are teaching, and I myself do the same, and I'm also bringing it to my practice and vice versa. So a lot of things I learned in Delft in the last 10 years that are now really very useful in my own practice. And of course, the other way around as well. So the method that we develop sort of becomes an engine to understand this complexity and to deal with this reality. In all of that, I think presentation and sharing is key. So we work in presentation. We are permanently presenting. And to do that, you have to make and think simultaneously, because you have to make presentations, models, drawings, visualizations, diagrams, everything is mentioned. And by doing that, we think. So what is then the role of the architect going to? I think it's for sure no longer the emphasis on the genius designer that produces this deus ex machina, the solution surprised, but it's simply hard teamwork. And I think that we have a shift from what I called from master builder to master explainer. Our role becomes more and more a sort of role that connects all these disciplines and all the stakeholders around topics that we deal with of the built environment, because we are able to visualize it and translate it in a common language. And this role makes us as architects actually again more interesting for our environment. What does it mean for design? Well, design, as I said, is not just a model for a possible future, but it's also a tool for communication, a tool to make people able or enable people to discuss and to exchange opinions, to get commitment, to make things moving. And I think, therefore, for that reason, design needs to be self-explaining and should not be the architect that has to explain his design. It should be explaining itself. Voilà. So what is architecture of the future? Not the future of architecture, but the architecture of the future. Yes, maybe it's automated interactive facilities. I see that buildings are becoming more and more a merge of technical installations, not only bricks, but more sensors, you could say. What does it mean for our education? We're trying to figure that out with the students, like I said. It remains a question that we can talk a bit about tonight.
Winnie, it's your turn.
That's great. Let me get my... Good to be together and good to continue, never stop, especially these days, and also in all kind of media and means. So that is and good to share, good to also discuss a little bit about the future here, about education in general, and what we should maybe do, and hopefully criticize each other in that way, in a constructive manner, so that we... So for me personally, it's good to see also you all, because I feel that, now I get also connected and somehow I understand you better. And that is a wish that we had indeed a while ago, Dick, already to get this done. So good that you witnessed this today. We're here in the Y Factory, and for me that's a kind of, that embodies basically also what I see in what education should be in architecture faculty. It was an attempt to emphasize, and it has been said also a little bit before by Kees, say discussion or talking or presentation. The tribune is more important than the rooms of the teachers below, and somehow to cheer us up with a kind of space which is not only gray and only wants to be distant. I mean, you can see that at the current there is an institute in Rotterdam which used to be very festive, the NAI, and currently is as somber as hell. So there's a, and this is, hopefully that changes in 2 months from now. So that's what the Y Factory tries to see in that way. Does it work? Can you, what do we do? Also that is that, because at the moment that it started was a distinction between bachelor and master. Where I see bachelor as like getting an overview of what are all the skills that we need. Maybe we have to select case, that's true. In architecture, the master should prepare you for research-oriented direction. So education becomes then a device in that, or a master education, according to me, with my simple proposal. I see also something which I find also partly terrible, especially in Delft. There are too many professors. Maybe thank you, Rins, of somehow to do another kind of role, and maybe I should resign also. But why do I say that? Because I think that professors in mass education need a sufficient amount of help, of assistance that can help to steer a little bit this research. Research is more than only teaching, therefore, and you need to get it into results. So, and how to find the budgets for that. I see also a landscape of master units, a European landscape of master units, and my dream is basically that they are all somehow very different, and or that there is a certain level of specialization involved, because that encourages this depth and makes it better. So what we do, and what I try to do as a small entity of this huge landscape, where I imagine that students go from lab to lab to explore basically these different, say, lunatics that are there to get a piece of the cake and a piece of the future in a way. So I only try to teach on the future city, not less and not more in that way. I could have selected something else, but this is what happened 10 years ago. How do I do that in that case? And the word, the Y factory, explains that a little bit, because it's like a tool to make an argumentative production. So it's a machine that produces these argumentations, in this case on the level of the future city as such. And that uses a certain kind of method. It's a balance between science and fiction. In that way, that's my marriage. To balance a little bit this dichotomy of in the university approach on design in that way. By telling stories, I can imagine and hypothesize on science in that. By certain argumentation, I can reach a certain level of science. Pseudoscience, I'm aware, but it helps to, but this is also not a PhD education, it's master's. So how do I imagine that? This triangle is actually hyper-classic. You can find it in any university. But here, I try to translate it into today's, way of working on it. I want to make models, and models are basically abstractions of reality. It's so abstract that I can apply it everywhere. A city of 1 million people, I do one change of a parameter, let's say fly everything and no buses anymore, then the whole city changes, the same matter. And then I can show it as a kind of abstract model. Secondly, I can apply in the viewing section on cities as such. That helps to collaborate with governments to get some money out of that and can then turn it again into this theory. And last but not least, the parameters that come out of it turn into a kind of controller, into a device, into a software, which I call the space fighter, that ultimately leads to a kind of understanding and a stacked, knowledge, almost historical to say that in your terms. So how? MSc 1 and 2, that's what we are doing, and sometimes MSc 3 and 4. Maybe I wouldn't mind to do another one in the nearby future, if that makes sense, Dick. So research-driven design is what it is. We do it in a group, studios. And there is that is also something, because architects want to become egos and want to become still master architects. How to combine that with individual, say, attempts? I think this compulsory individual studies for a certain subject can lead to a comparative approach for a subject and deepens it. I will explain that later. So who are we? Only a small group of people. Some of them are here around, but due to the these collaborations further away of similar, lunatics, I can imagine that we do some more depth and require also more money and more knowledge in that way. Products, output is it called? Yes, books, software, exhibitions and talks. And that leads to kind of sequence as such. I think I'm proud on the titles. Every time I need to get some extra money to find out how to do that. It promises my students that they are all authors in the wider world. It's a combination of words, logics, and visualizations.
And just to illustrate how what kind of parameters come out of it, in The Green Dream, one of the first books, we made 22 observations. Why 22? 22 students, it's how it is. But they all take like arguments to the max and say that green is actually ugly. It is paralyzing, it's slow, it's misleading, and it's not enough, to say some of them, of these results of this kind of studio. That led to a calculator. In order to make it better, we have to compare with each other, and then we can make the greenest city, is what the logic was about. And we do that by sexy, say, illustrations based on innovations that lead to beautiful Barcelona, better Amsterdam, and better Phuket at that moment. So, and porosity, again, a kind of example of doing that every student does something from his or her perspective, but makes it comparative in that book that is there. And that was where this kind of sequence of towers, and everybody makes basically a kind of change in one of the towers, step by step by step, based on his or her obsessions, intuitive obsessions in the beginning. And that leads to a certain kind of, say, post-scripting, finally, instead of pre-scripting that is there, and some other titles that I will not explain at this moment. Just to give a peek review, what is the next? Because what is this method then about? You do things to the max, and then it reveals immediately next steps of things that we don't know. So by these books, by these studios, I have a limited, but certain, say, a kind of acquaintance of knowledge is what it does. Next time soon, Planet Maker, which wants to describe this cute element, this sphere, this ball, to make it and see what is happening and what kind of changes we can expect in that way. Do we want to have this planet? And how do we communicate that? And I want to do it next time in Davos to somehow that these people are squeezed between this future so that we can imagine a kind of discussion. The second thing is everything is urbanism. I want to span the gap or say this incredible, say, stupidity that urbanism is a bit hidden in this building. So what to do it? I love that job. Is that by Domus, and the Y Factory was part of the Domus exercise of 2019, to talk with many people, turn this magazine into a book at this very moment, based on this, all these people that are thinking about urbanism, from toilet makers to politicians, from urbanists to planners as such. And that has been, that's the magazine. This is the effect, what we described on the planet, and that will be soon in that book. And in Ego comes out just after February, I dream about how egoism can turn into wegoism, and by tests done by different students to force this game into a negotiation tool, how that we can, say, celebrate this beautiful combination of yourself and us in that way. And yes, the Green Dip, now getting some money today, finally some budget to the show, also this tool that based maybe on others that do that, we are not alone. I agree with you, Carola, that we are built on an evolutionary system of people, that we, in this case, make an inventory with many universities, visit Stefano Boeri, on what plants need in that way, what they give in oxygen and etc. What kind of tools are there, products that are already or that we need to invent, and then say use this kind of places as a canvas to dress it up and to see its effects as such. Yes, finally, I think that New York can become cute and nice in that way, or that places become somehow a mitigation between future and past. So that leads also to calculations that what is the effect on albedo, on the biomass, on the carbon that's stored, but also on the temperature that we help with this, if we do it on any flat roof. And then yes, 1 degrees, we will save the planet partly with that, is what this operation is about in that way. So, and I end with biodiversity, of course, because plants are nice, but we need to maintain them. I need these guys to do that. So this studio explores what is the new habitat that we can imagine, what are the tools we need, and how can we dress the city up so that ultimately we can give this kind of catalog to be sold in IKEA to imagine, therefore, this kind of a combination of small and big. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Winnie. Anna, it's your turn.
Hello, everyone. My name is Anna Pereira-Roders. I'm a professor of heritage and values in the Department of Architectural Engineering and Technology. And I gladly accept the invitation to come and have a debate with you and these dear colleagues, which already by the discourses, you will see that I structurally disagree. So I look forward to the debate afterwards. I'll go next. And next. So design education is something which is very dear to me, and I would like to share with you my experience as a student as well, as architect, and later on as a teacher, a professor in design education. And if we can really debate and discuss, I really see that in particular the focus and the primarily learning goals and were very much on product, what we would like to show. We have seen it now, presentation, case also highlighted, is very important. And process somehow, even though it's not really official, it doesn't count in our grades, but indirectly you need to study it or develop it or think about it. But we'll come back to that. And you see there the architect as an isolated. We have heard already other colleagues talking about it. How I see it that it could change, or how I see it that is changing, is it accepting that the architect is never alone, also in the architectural practices. You're designing for someone, you are working with others. And I think that we are not practicing enough all this diversity of what it could be as a different model of designing. What I also notice is that we don't focus yet too much on the impact of what our designs and products bring to society, to the environment, and as such, that our own attitude as designers, what we say is ugly and how that affects our design decisions, that we really have a strong reflection on what are we doing and what is our footprint on those products. Also to think more about the process, but I will explain that later on in the next slides. So I start with the process, and I would really like or dream about a degree where you can really explore, like if you were cooking, right? So that you say in a studio, this time I'm going to follow a certain process, I have a certain timeline, I'm going to involve this or other actors, and I'm going to see the context in which I am, and that it might affect the process and the product where you are developing. And of course, there are situations in reality when you are a practitioner that will be more, or you say the dependent and independent variables, that you can that change that more than others, but especially the later ones, which we have also heard the other colleagues talking, the tools you are using, if it's more manual or digital, the sources you are basing yourself upon to make up design decisions, that should be playing a role on the process you chose, and that it's not the same process the moment you enter here as a bachelor student and that you graduate as a master, as if you didn't learn enough the different processes you could follow. Even if you disagree with the process, just to explore it. Then impact, we have heard a little bit here and there about it, to be aware of what we are doing and what our product can do to society, to the environment, if it's economical enough in cultures where there are not enough resources. I think we should think further. And not just focus on the product, but what the product brings to others. And even though it is sometimes there, it is often also just a good intention. You cannot actually prove it's true. So, and I would like to see that in our education, that actually the many beautiful words that architects say, that they can actually prove that it is really reality. And I said I was going to be provocative, so to feed the discussion. And most of all, in attitude, I really think we need, and we have seen it already, a generation shift in how we see the architect from the past, and now I would hope that it would be an architect for the future. So that it would not matter anymore if you think a building is ugly or not, you treat it with the same respect and you address it and you give it the potential for a future development or a future adaptive reuse or a renovation, and you take more control and you see the city as your own patients and as your own, as if you were a doctor. Then you're not anymore just focused on how I think or it should be and my decisions, but you understand that as an architect, you're playing a role, and it's a fascinating role because architects are often very interdisciplinary, to complement with each other, with the engineers, with the policymakers, with the users, the owners, to see how can you complement yourself there to be of added value. And like I said, in relationship to the process, that you're not just doing and not thinking about why you are doing what you're doing, but that you plan ahead and you think, what should I do in order to be proactive as a designer? And this on the marketeer goes very deep into some frustrations, you could say, where for a long time, I was taught myself as a student as well, but also I saw students being taught that as if they would have to hide all the weak spots of the project or the disadvantages, or what would they not be with the fear of not being graded as high as they could. And I think that a thorough discussion, being more critical on exactly what is the positive aspects of a project and a solution and the negative, that would reach help our discipline to go a step forward. And then enough about hearing, oh, this inspired me, but actually reference all the great architects that were in the past, the references of works, of written works. We don't have references enough in our discipline and in our field, and I think that it would be also a good step forward. To finish, also not be afraid of failing, and of showing different ways, and that's why I think it's a process as a whole degree, reflecting, being critical on yourself, being critical on the product which you had developed, and every time try to reach an impact higher and higher and higher, so that also our societal challenges and environmental challenges can be solved. So that is my Sinterklaas list, my wish list for the education of the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Anna, for a very clear and concise presentation. And the final presentation is by Seffel.
Thank you very much, Dick. Thanks a lot for organizing such a wonderful event, Javier, especially. Thank you. I am the last, but hopefully not least, to give you some thoughts about the future of the education, architecture education. Well, my name is Sevil Sarıyıldız, for the ones who doesn't know me. I am the professor of design informatics at the Architectural Engineering and Technology Department. I have 5 slides, not much, but I would like to begin with the architects. What is the main task of an architect? Architects and urban planners, I could also say, they create living environment for all entities, not only for human being, but for plants, for animals, for everything. And in that sense, architecture is a science which deals with alpha, beta, and gamma sciences. What do I mean with it? Alpha mind scientist deals with the subjective world of beauty and moral, represented by the artistic, intuitive soul. Beta mind scientist deals with the world, objective world of facts and logic, represented by the rational mind. And the gamma mind scientist considers the interest of society and culture. So the integration of these 3 Science disciplines make the architecture complex, but very unique. And architects and planners have big responsibilities in that sense for the society, because the buildings and cities are the most enduring elements of our culture and the legacy for the future. So, if you look at the metaphor here, the management scientists, they say, 5% of the knowledge of architects is the explicit knowledge, what we see. But the 95% of the knowledge is like in the iceberg, it is tacit knowledge. So tacit knowledge is the knowledge that is very difficult to transfer to another persons, by means of writing or verbalizing it. That requires especially personal contact and trust to share your knowledge. So therefore, we need trained and experienced architect teachers, like my colleagues, wonderful colleagues, to teach architects. Experience is very important in this. So architecture is in this sense absolutely more than form giving. It is an intelligent process, deals with soft aspects such as intuition, creativity, aesthetics, and many other parameters, technical, social, as I mentioned in the earlier slide. But I would like to just look with you very quickly. What do we mean? We are talking about nowadays a lot about data, artificial intelligence, this and that, but what do we do with it as architects? So, data is representation of facts, symbols, without meaning. For instance, this is noise, but without any meaning. If we put useful process data with meaning and purpose, then we are talking about information, which is data plus. Information plus is the data and information with intelligence. Then we talk about knowledge. And our, in fact, main purpose is to come to the meta-knowledge, to wisdom. And that is knowledge plus, which has evaluated understanding, cognition, and comprehension. And in this sense, it is very important, the experience, doing it. Once more, the architect's knowledge, again, you see the explicit and the tacit knowledge, which deals with meta-knowledge. But the question is in this, how to make this knowledge and wisdom explicit and transfer to the students, to young generations, to teach?
What we have built up is a global network of collaborating engineers who have special machinery which we develop with them, or we found them to integrate in our delivery process.
The Galaxy Soho required a paradigm shift on the client side because of the nature of its design. It was the first really curvaceous design they were attempting. They needed to buy into the idea that there would be a process that would allow us to implement that design. And that process, on one hand, was the adoption of the 3D platform as a foundation for documenting and resolving the geometry, but also using it as a vehicle for getting the project built downstream.
All of these software tools are there to manage the complexity, to make it quantifiable, to make it predictable, so that we deliver projects both where the client can visualize it, they can see it, they can have walkthroughs through it.
It was just a very small fragment which I cut it from the longer video of late Zaha Hadid architects. This was just an example. There are many, many examples, of course. But here, what I want to say is buildings are getting complex. If we compare with Middle Ages, buildings are getting more complex, not only in their scale, but also in their function, form, building techniques, but also the demands are getting continuously increasing and increasing from different actors, from government, from users, from contractors, or imagine continuously growing this, increasing. So during the conceptual phase of the architectural design, from initiative till the demolition, it is a circular, iterative process. The most important decisions are taken in the conceptual phase of the design, which has an enormous impact for the entire life cycle quality of the buildings and built environment. So the question is, from my profession side, how can we put in computational tools, methods, and techniques to test in this phase, in conceptual phase, before any construction take place, to test the performance of buildings? And then I say form follows function and performance in the entire life cycle, which includes maintenance and asset. So performance-based computational design method which treats the complexity in design which relates to soft and hard aspects. What do I mean? Soft aspects are the human aspects, such as qualitative aspects, form, aesthetic, and culture, and so on. And the hard physical aspects, those are the quantitative aspects, such as construction, sustainability, safety, climate and energy, indoor environment as such, to be considered during the conceptual phase of the design. In this sense, we can briefly say that what is the contribution of information, communication, and knowledge technology in the building sector? If we look at the sector during the last decades, it is from product design to urban design by modeling and collaboration in design, construction, manufacturing, realization, and operational services. Visualization and analysis of performance of buildings and built environment, and search for optimal solutions as an enabler for data, information, and knowledge processing, reuse, and communication, and also as a partner by using intelligent methods, soft computing technologies such as agent technologies, data mining, neural networks, fuzzy logic, to help you, to support you during the decision process. So in this sense, contribution of computational design is not only, but especially relevant for the complex buildings. In this example, what I saw is an interdisciplinary MVO project funded by the MVO under leading of Michaela Turin and Martin Tempirik. It is a collaborative project within the Department of IIT, together with master's students. They contributed a lot in this project, and they developed this digitally produced thromba wall. This is my last slide, because I thought it should be only 5 slides. To make it short, what is my vision on the future of design education? I think the future, more and more, it will be integral design studios. We already have it. But still, in the future, more and more, perhaps, is my suggestion, to set up integral design studios in the form of research-based education. Because without embedding research findings in the education, it is difficult to talk about innovation. Then I can imagine that during the last period, what we have seen and experienced in the pandemic period, we can say that we should do augmented learning in the future more and more, perhaps. That means virtual and real mixed, by integrating various disciplines and with various specialist teachers at the studio. It is already happening. I know my son is studying at this moment KSK studio, and they have teachers from architecture and building technology, I understood, in the studios. And embedding the performance-based computational design method in some cases integrated, and integrated lab facilities such as fast prototyping, modeling as such, real and online operation. It is also possible nowadays to operate it online. And at the end, finally, learning by doing in real and virtual workspace as intermingled in the studio farming. Here I have an example for you what we are doing all years in the Building Technology Master Program in MEGA. This is a studio. I don't know if you can read it. The letters are too small. But six different disciplines are integrated in this studio, such as computational designer, building manager, facade designer, structural engineer, architect, climate designer. They are all integrated in the studio. Natalie De Vries is part of it. Mauro, also structural designer, professor, and many others. So the students are building in Rotterdam in Vierhaven, high-rise building. And they are looking at the form generation, performance evaluation, and optimization in a collaborative design environment using BIM, building information modeling tools, with different specialists, as I said, six different specialist teachers and topics. And the student get positioned as one student being architect, other one being manager, as such. This was what I wanted to tell you this evening. I hope we can have a nice debate, exchange ideas. And thank you very much for listening to me, to the virtual and real audience, and my colleagues, of course. Thanks for being
with me. Thank you, Seffel. Okay. I will not try to summarize what has been said. Well, what is clear, and of course that has always been, I think, one of the characteristics, but I think also qualities of our faculty, that we look at the field of design, architecture, and urbanism through very different lenses. I think tonight we see that again. But that's probably also, let's say, the start of a discussion. And maybe, yeah, I could start with a question and also to make it very tangible, a discussion on the future of design education here. Well, what is also clear, I think, in the contributions is it's very difficult to talk about the future. So the way you base your vision on the future very much of what's happening now, today, and what you're doing now. And I don't say that as a criticism, but I think that's inevitable, because in a way, also, we don't know the future. We are not predicting the future, but based on what you're doing now, you try to give us a forward-looking perspective. But as I said, to make it really tangible in relation to our education, there are some words, if we would have a computer collecting all the data of the words, and we would have this fashionable word cloud. I tried to make one. So, of course, the word multidisciplinary has been mentioned quite a lot. Complexity, teamwork, integral design, a statement, not by everyone, but that triggered also my thoughts, was everything is urbanism. So I was wondering, if we look at our education today, are we not horribly, let's say, lagging behind and old-fashioned? So is the way we let our students graduate, I think, which is still very focused on the product, the final project, that was also mentioned a couple of times. It should be less about the product, but more about impact or process. So should we change that? Should we change the way we expect our students to leave our faculty? And another thing, very much triggered by everything is urbanism. Could also say everything is architecture, everything is landscape. But is also the idea that we force our students to select a master track. Is that also not horribly old-fashioned? Two questions, but I think related. So I would also like to involve the audience, but let's start with this six professionals on their chairs. Case, I saw you already.
I just made a small remark. I say we can also say everything is history.
Yeah. But maybe you can also start to react on
well,
this.
Well, you know, my I have an idea about this, individual graduation that is sort of bugging me. I mean, I think it's important, and Winnie has it also in his presentation, that we sort of balance between sort of individual expression and individual development, but also the ability to work in a team and to work in a sort of integrated way. And I also think it's inevitable because in practice it's what's happening, you know. So nobody's waiting for that genius individual anymore. And I'm not referring to complexity as difficult forms and shapes. I'm referring to complexity as complexity of the questions that come towards us, and then we have to give them simple answers and not complex answers, but that's my point of view. But so I've been at some points trying to bring to the discussion, that, say, changing the end terms of our graduation in such a way that there is more possibility to also judge the students, or to judge but also test them on their ability to work in teams and to do that kind of work, and not only judge them for their individual end product, definitely. So yes, that's one thing.
Who wants to? Several? You want to react?
First of all, I think you understood. Perhaps I didn't make it clear. I'm not talking about the form complexity. Form is also getting complex by means of these 3D modeling techniques, of course. But complexity is in its entire life cycle. Also, everything is. What I want to say is react on the first thing that you said, Dirk. I think this verkokering, I don't know in English what is verkokering, of that students are not allowed to choose, for instance, only in the master program, they can choose master architecture, master building technology. And I get a lot of questions from the, for instance, architecture students. Why cannot we take this design informatics, for instance, in our master program? But it is in the organization not possible to do it. It is too much in the hocus.
Ah, we can change that, of course, if we want.
Yeah.
Yeah, why not?
I think so.
Riens, everything is urbanism. What is your...
No, I think that's... I would opt for... I think the only way out is everything is landscape.
Yeah.
Ik ben half doof, hè, dus je moet echt hard praten, wil je. Ja, everything is landscape. And that's because of... what I think is the only or last remaining serious parameter that has universal value, or almost universal value in design, or should have, which is sustainability.
So in the end, we have the track here is sustainability, and not make these other.
Well, the other thing that you have, I think, have
so-called disciplinary divisions.
I don't know, but we have to not step into the trap of wanting to deliver, wanting to train students with the hope that they are finished professionals by the day they leave school. We have the not just the opportunity, but the necessity to select which portion of the entire teaching do we teach in these, let's say, 5 years. I think we're all still learning as much as we learned when we were younger, and trying to get everything on cram everything into our program in 5 years, it would be a big mistake. So we have to make a selection, which ends up in my proposal to focus on basic skills. So rather leave out the complexity and just teach basic skills that learn you how, teach you how to start dealing with complexity. You will never get there, also not if you...
Is it for the bachelor or for the master?
For all. Basic skills in architecture and urban design and history, and at least in let me talk about the things I do know, architecture, urbanism and landscape. Also, 5 years is not enough. So basic skills in knowledge, basic skills in how to handle the knowledge, so in the method of dealing with lots of people asking lots of different questions of you. That's it. So I think I'm pleading for simplicity instead of simplicity in the approach so that you can handle the complexity.
I protest. I think because basicness is evolving as we speak, because we're building on layers of knowledge that comes out of that. The plea for staying basic in that way, mm-hmm. with this accumulating knowledge, that I can understand, because that makes it clear in that way. But I would like to add to that that it's not going back into basicness, because then we should go to Zurich.
No, forward
or
in
to,
basic.
To the Swiss schools, which I think is a...
Forward toward basic.
I want
basic.
To nuance it a little bit. That's
but maybe to chime in on that, you could, one hand, it's about process, as you say, it's about transitions, I would say. It's about creating enough free space so that you actually have room to make that change. And you can see it very basically in the port of Rotterdam that wants to have petroleum and energy. But you can also say the more freedom you give our students, and I truly believe in that, you see that teams form. And I've been impressed how well our students do teamwork on their own, and they find their own place. And I tend to give them the assessment, okay, afterwards you give me a one page or a paragraph, how well the team worked, so that I can, if I grade the team as a whole, well, that's it. But giving students the free space, the good students know what to do with free space. There are other students who need more help, and they are the ones that we need to support. So I think there should be a kind of grading system from, not grading system in terms of grade, but there should be a place, a space, an opportunity for the good students to be nurtured and the other ones to be helped so that they have enough. And that's not by giving them assignments down to, you have to write times Roman 12, whatever, but to really creating them the space so that everyone can grow. And in that sense, I agree with what you said. I think it's a teacher-learner community. And I think if we stopped learning, it would be boring.
But so, Carola, are you proposing a new Christiania here? That we are completely no structure, only student groups that discuss about what they should do?
I mean, no, not at all. But I think there needs to be enough space to leave them the room to develop and not being completely boxed in by principals that by... So, yes, you need space to develop. Not everything needs to be free, but there needs to be some openness.
In our studios, I have to then also talk a bit about CP, is actually the format we use is very rigorous. And in that, there's a lot of freedom, and there is a strong urge from the teachers and from us to let the students work together, but within that, the rigor of the format, so that in the end, there is a co-production, that it goes in a certain direction and that the output is comparable between the different groups and individuals. And that, in fact, the entire studio is working on one big, you could say, installation or exhibition or book or whatever, one big thing that can be shown, and that is also an output that is that can be called master science research, because the design is, of course, it's a quest, and especially the graduation studio, it's really a search from students into certain topics that we define. But the so it's not about letting it go and letting everybody sort of randomly work together. It's very structured. It's very well organized. And but it's sort of also within that framework gives a huge amount of freedom and space. And I think that's exactly when I came out of Delft a couple of years ago as a student. It was what I sort of at that time during my education missed, and I found in the office where I started working. I found limits and borders and structure and how things had to be done. And inside that limits and borders and structure, I found a lot of freedom, because then you could start focusing and finally go in a certain direction.
I have not an answer to you. I wanted to go back to your questions, Dick, because I think that's very good that you did that. It's like, are we old-fashioned here, you asked me, end of the quote. And which I appreciate that you asked that question. I think it's very good to evaluate ourselves. Now, let me start that I think TU Delft, bouwkunde, is completely not radical in itself. If it's radical, then it's about radically declaring the supermarket system of generically subdivided subjects as an answer to our world. And that I protest indeed against this generically subdivided worlds where, say, you have public housing or museums or whatever, this kind of ways of dealing with it. It makes it, it because it is not how the world is looking at this moment, and it is how, and it's also not completely helping specialism or depth in that way. So, and that is, I have a worry in that way. And if you then ask, what do we think about the master tracks, as you say, are they old-fashioned? End of the quote. Is again, they are partly they are, because they're based on that systematics of how we look to architecture from this kind of categorized, generically categorized elements. Can we escape, is my next question to you, from this kind of non-radicality in this place, which is almost impossible because of the bureaucratic, say, systems in this, and we all protest, we all feel frustrated by that, and we don't know how to handle. We try to commute in different organizations every time to escape from it and to find new roles, and they're very hard in that way. That's what we probably share in its way. I don't know. What would be a possibility? Can we imagine indeed maybe a complete 1 year out of this system and declare everything what we should have, we should do now, not there? Is that possible? Can we suggest maybe possible moments of complete liberty or anarchy that could be suggested? Can we divide, or can we think about something where we could make a kind of incredible funny project together? Can we then indeed learn from Eindhoven, as you say, in the Dutch, the academy, where we base it on other categories and subcategories?
There is a simpler start, because I think here you can learn from urbanism. All the things that you're describing are clearly attributes of architecture, not of urbanism. So we can start by a walk along the corridor and then take the train to Eindhoven.
Well, I agree with you that urbanism is has more overview than architecture sometimes do.
And we don't have the old-fashioned typological characterization.
Well, partly. Sometimes urbanism thinks about scale, like regional planning versus urban design. Take care.
Yeah. But our faculty is called Architecture and Built Environment. In itself, that's already strange, because isn't architecture the built environment, or should it not only be built environment? Landscape is also built, of course, especially here in the Netherlands. But
environment.
To make those distinctions in itself is like like you said, let's call everything landscape, let's call everything built environment or man-made environment.
Every year there's another everything. So everything is was urbanism last year, everything is landscape the next time.
I completely everything is
scripting. I would love to have that we forbid ourselves to not script for 1 year and to so everything is then parameterized, everything is materialized, I don't know, or everything is economy, also another quite a cool one, yeah. to dedicate that and to have that, maybe that would help.
Is mass hysteria?
Yeah. Well, in the end, you know, it's still just architecture on the building, eh, and the big sign. And you know why that is? Because there was a proposal to add and the built environment, but then Welstand from the municipality of Delft didn't approve of the design. But it's not relevant at all. But,
but well, maybe I just, sorry, yeah. Anna, but just one point more on your plea for urbanism. What urbanism also has is that it looks much more at the hidden designers, I would say. So everything that's about planning in urbanism to looking at land use, zoning, legal systems, all of that, I think that's something that is very important and valuable, and it's a hidden designer that maybe on the architecture side we're not exploring enough. So just to support your argument. Sorry, Anna.
Yeah, but only one thing. Urbanism is not sexy. So that's completely, especially here in the faculty.
Look at what state the planet is in.
I agree.
Well, in some countries, architecture is inclusive. In many degrees, you don't have the division, as in urbanism, building technology, and architecture. So I think this could be an entry, being an international master, that maybe we could explore this opportunity of having the different tastes and expertises. I do think we are old-fashioned. But I'm also an heritage expert, so I also think we can learn from the old fashioned and we can develop on the new as well.
Maybe we made a step backward when the departments were started. Well, we all know we are getting old, but when we were studying here, urban design and a part of what is now architecture was one group. Mm-hmm. So there was not this what we now call disciplinary, I don't know if that's the right word, division. Yeah. And
in some countries,
it's not
does
written
not even
in the
exist.
Law
yeah.
that we have this division.
But if we change the entire organization, it doesn't change the education.
No.
I don't believe that. So I think we can talk about this for the rest of the night.
But I think it's better than to look at education and how we can change that. But also instead about of designing a new structure of the faculty, because that's what in
so
the
let's
end
go
we
back
always
to the
do.
Students then.
But we don't think about the contact. We just design a new structure for the faculty.
We're talking about design education on whatever skill, if it's the entire planet that Winnie wants to do, or if it's one building, or it's a landscape, or whatever. But I think that what is really, or what should be really different, is move the emphasis so from, say, the self-centered way of teaching students to think, to a way of how can I use my brain to connect with other brains to become bigger, because that's what we need to do to manage, say, not the shape complexity. I'm not talking about making complexity, but understanding it. And I read in Wired, there was this article on artificial intelligence, and I read that still today, the computational capacity of the human brain is still, of one human brain, is still larger, I don't know if this is true, than the entire computational capacity of all the computers in the world.
Of course.
Imagine if you connect 100 human brains, how much capacity you have then. Well, we cannot do that physically, but we can do that through communication. And that's why that's what we're trying to do with our diagrams and our drawings. And you said this tacit knowledge needs to be excavated. And that's what we're trying to do. That's what we have to focus on, how to do that.
That was also the first
case and others. I get many students, and most of them in the masters cannot analyze well, they cannot draw well, and they cannot present well.
So are these things that we teach them?
But that's because you're in urbanism. In architecture, they can do that. Yeah. And if not, we teach them in MC1 immediately.
This is, I wanted to avoid the bachelor versus master discussion, but now I'm now looking at the audience. Does someone of you want to react? I think some things were quite provocative. What do you think? Yeah. Is there a... Yeah.
Okay, hey, thank you for your kind of presence here, I guess. So basically, let's see, I have had this concern from the moment I got here, which is that sometimes BK feels and looks very sterile. Everything looks like a very well-prepared experiment in a very controlled environment. And with time, I discovered perhaps that had to do with a certain lack of politics. Politics have become this fancy topic for lectures, you know, or just an option you have, but there's no political engagement or encouragement, nor spatially. You don't feel that there are spaces for that, nor in the programs, you know. Sometimes I feel this, so this is basically where I'm starting.
Okay.
This.
I think it's a good remark.
Now, yeah.
But sorry.
Oh.
I thought you were finished.
I'm gonna take a bit. Sorry.
Yeah.
I'm gonna give you like my view of this. So I believe perhaps this has to. And I don't know why I'm giving you a view before a question, but anyways. So perhaps it has to do with a very practical culture of the Netherlands, because we are in a technical university. You know, problem solving over debate sometimes. Or debates only oriented to solving problems. But there's also, I think, this curse that has, you know, yeah, I don't know, perhaps, yeah, TU Delft has to deal with it, which is the curse of being recognized and being a number two faculty, etc. And those things have a weight. I know they do. So my question is, and I also say, I'm not saying this because when I wrote one of these articles from BNews, I'm from BNews here, I interviewed Herman Herzberger and Francine Hoven and other teachers from the faculty, and it was evident that this used to be a very political university. And somehow, somehow that was ruled out. I guess for you, perhaps you managed to see, the ones of you who studied here before, the consequences of being so political, and perhaps you say, oh yeah, it was harder. But we don't, and I think this generation, at least mine, is starting to see that there's a need for politics. You could call them anarchy, but I believe that these horizontal things are still necessary. So
yeah, I want to
where
react.
Is politics, you will, basically? That's my question.
One thing,
thank
of
you.
Course, be not too long.
Very good.
But
thank
this,
you. Yeah.
Thank you, but I, it's good that you say it. In general, I think that that we have to be more political. In to be, because it's so much society connected. Again, polis means city, so it's again everything is urbanism, but fine. So political we have to be. I would say advise you, please, we have a professor specially dedicated for that, Wouter van Stiphout, so he should take that if he's still around.
No, he had a temporary appointment and he just stopped, so.
Ah, that's sad,
yeah.
That's sad, because he was very strong in that.
Yeah.
I admired him in maybe a couple of years ago a lot on that level, so then we have a vacancy. Last but not least, we also can, I think you have to go to GSAP in Columbia, in New York, because that's the most political school that is in the world. So then we also can specialize between schools. Right? So so my answer is a bit double. And what do we take here and what do we give to New York to in that way? Or how do we build up a relationship with GSAP to learn from them or to comment them in that way? So this is about political. So I'm a yes and no.
Carola?
Yeah, maybe to follow up on that, I think the idea of critical thinking is based or is geared to that direction. You have to position yourself somewhere. And I think there's a difference between a school standing for a specific approach. I have to say I studied at La Cambre when La Cambre in Brussels was also making proposals for the citizen initiatives in the city and just producing basically for that ongoing politics at the time. But what we need is people who go in and think about what does something imply. So in my Building Green course, I actually take Winnie's book to start with and have the students critique it and figure out and take buildings of, I think several Dick, they've taken Meccano's buildings and so on, to actually say, what does sustainability mean? Social sustainability, environmental sustainability, cultural sustainability. How is it marketed and what is actually behind it? And if you get to that point of critical thinking, I would say, then you can also form a political opinion. And then you are hopefully, I mean, we should be talking about all the fake news and all the other things that are going on right now, to have our students be aware of what decisions they make and how that is interacting with politics. And architects and planners are multipliers. When an architect does something, it has way more effect on the built environment than even if hundreds, thousand people sometimes move. So that awareness is something that I strongly believe we need to be nurturing way more strongly.
Yeah, and I think that's also why we start this BK Talks. Eh? Next time we could start a discussion about buildings and continue. But I think, yeah, maybe your question triggered me very much. Well, it's one thing is good that at the moment the faculty is sterile because it means that we can continue teaching in this period. But I started my studies here when I think the faculty and I think some of you as well was still very much political. And I don't look back on that as a very positive thing because in a way there was a lot of discussion, but there was no real discussion because it was very judgmental also. So you were either good or wrong. It was you were on the right side or on the wrong side. And for me, that was quite shocking to experience when I became a student here, but also it didn't help at all. But
no, I agree with that. I have that same sort of memory. I also think that for politics you came to the wrong country, you could say. It's the political landscape is as flat as the landscape when you look out of your window.
Everything is landscape.
Yes, maybe it is. But on the other hand, I also want to go back to something Carola said about the impact of architecture and things like that. Yes, but don't overestimate, and civil also, don't overestimate the role of the architect when we do big projects, because the big projects are projects that are done by the community, by society. They want to do the projects, they make careful selections, there's a lot of people involved in steering it from the client side, etc., etc. And of course, the architect participates and takes his role in that. But it's not like you are the one that defines all this what's going on outside. We are participants in this process. Of course, you can decide not to do it, like Rins has decided not to be a professor. And that's something you can do. But it doesn't go much further beyond that.
I don't know if that would, but I hope you don't plead for modesty, eh?
No, I don't plead for in the role of the architect, not. But I plead for understanding where our strength is and not assuming that we define everything and decide everything. Design choices, for instance, I heard, or design decisions. Somebody used the word design decision.
No, but I think there was the word impact came a couple of times. Yeah. I want to add that to your list.
But a design decision is something that is sort of discovered in the process. It's not like the architect, after difficult meetings, he makes the decision. It's not going like that at all. Yeah. Echt not at all.
And in that sense, I think that it would really benefit the students if they can really test and simulate this diversity in situations where, for example, the citizens are very vocal and they are actually deciding the most, and you have to deal with it. And now I think the studios are quite flat in what are you allowed to do and not how you decide and not who do you involve. And I think it could be very interesting in this level of thinking forward to explore this even more in the studios.
Nowadays, our students, they spend their 5 years, yeah, maybe it takes them seven, but the 5 years of the curriculum in the faculty. Okay, they go on a field trip, but they stay here.
In a comfort bubble, I think it really
would
help them.
Should we go out? Should we send the students out for
definitely.
A year to...
Well, I would, sorry.
No, please go ahead.
I plead definitely for this kind of system. And now it's a bit more difficult, this kind of super Erasmus system, that you can go to places that have a kind of an other kind of identity. This shop around, that I think is beautiful of Europe. It's not completely there yet. It's still, most of the schools are more of the same. They all teach scripting, or they all teach technology or housing, but honestly, I think it's very good if we can develop that in Europe. So it would be. I hope you can help Dick for that.
Wait, can I say something?
Just a second. I'm not talking about the bachelor students then, but our master students. Half of them are coming from another place, so they come here to be here,
but
not
maybe
to be sent away
mean
again.
That they should go to another school, but they should spend a year outside of the school.
Yeah, but that's they are only 2 years here, so the master students. So there's like 200 every year or coming from that didn't do our bachelor but come from other universities. They come here to be here, not to be sent away again.
Can I also say something?
Yeah, certainly.
But I heard that politics, I have totally different connotations with that word now. If you look at the world situation in percentages, at this moment, up to the research results, 80% of the world population is living in very bad living conditions. They don't have a normal house, 80%. In that sense, if you look at it from that perspective, we are only dealing with very luxury problems here in developed countries, the rich countries, I would say. In that sense, I really agree that we should have a politics in that as a leading faculty of architecture, as second, sometimes first in the world, that we should have a world politic by saying how and what will be our contribution to improve those circumstances. Do we have a politic? Do we have an education in that topic as such? I think we should do something with it.
I think we do, maybe not enough.
But one thing I would like to say about it, nothing stops you from being political. I really don't see where the university comes in. Be political. Be political together with other people that want to be political and go practice it.
But maybe I think what may be missing is an awareness of diversity and how to handle that, and diversity writ large. And I usually give my example, having lived in Japan for 5 years and 100 ways to say yes, 50 of them mean no. And that is happening in this faculty too. I had the experience talking with a student from a European nation and an Asian nation. Oh, these people never do what they say. Yes, but have you even asked if this yes actually means yes or if it means no? So we actually have the opportunity to get the foreign in the local if we use it appropriately to get the people talking to each other in a structured, in a way that is respective and that respects the different backgrounds and values them.
Thank you. I'm looking for a final question statement in the audience, yeah? Please come to the foreground.
Do you hear me? Yeah. So listening to you all tonight, you're all talking about this change that the architect is becoming in this world, how that how his task may be changing throughout history, and now it's changing again. And I myself am not so familiar with the change itself, but I do feel that change, as in, for example, with computer science engineers, they are now becoming more and more builders of our society in terms of privacy, in terms of data. Like, there are no laws, and they are creating this history, but the faculty, for example, computer science, is not made half about ethics. They're not focusing on that, while the role of these people is changing. And I'm asking myself how this faculty is coping with that change in the architectural world for the architects. So I don't know to who that question is, maybe to you all, maybe to the dean, maybe I'd, but.
Yeah, I can pick it up. I also put that we should put attitude in our curricula, so I think it goes hand in hand with ethics as well. I think it's really something we could have developed and explored with our students. We have courses on ethics, but it's not that you really explore that in your design decisions. So if you decide, for example, in heritage level to demolish a lot with community's value as important, or if you are putting up a very high ecological footprint, how you deal with your constructors, with your policymakers. I really think that we should be there much more reflective than we are now. So definitely, I think it should be a question coming.
I see a beautiful project coming up from you, because yeah. I can imagine pamphlets and posters here in this building where you say no concrete or whatever. Where are the ethics in that way? Or let's hack Google to give you an advice. Where are you? What we just did, by the way, with computer science to have Google Maps to have this brain drain in Google Maps. So please make that list. I think it's super cool to make how can ethics, because we don't feel ethics in our practice at that. Yeah. Only sometimes we are edgy in our practice. Shall I go and work for Gazprom, yes or not? Is what, like, then it comes to life.
Even, for example, the discussions of high rise, when you have a clear beschermd staatsgezicht, a conservation area, and that there is a disrespect between urbanists and architects. So I think that we don't discuss it enough. In this also.
No, maybe we are a little bit complacent in that field, because it's also a very good contribution. I think for many years we thought here in this faculty, oh, we're the only one in this TU, the rest are just engineers, but we always have an ethical view as well. But you see how everything is changing, and AI is now the word. All the other faculties, and we as well, are heavily investing in that. But it raises a lot of ethical issues. Mm-hmm. And I think they're more intensely addressed now in the other faculties than in our faculty.
But there is one dilemma, I think. There's a systemic dilemma. That is, there are so many different topics. Let me say, outside of design, that you can add to design during your years at university, that we will be spreading our resources extremely thin. And so I keep asking the question. I don't have an answer, but I have a gut feeling. It's better to leave ethics to the people. It's not that they don't get the chance to get involved in ethics if we don't teach it. I'm sure you discuss ethics all the time. You read about ethics, you think about ethics. And if you think it's a very important subject, you can do that. Free society, you can do that as much as you want.
Yeah.
Maybe the better choice is some of one of the things that I've tried to put on the table tonight is, instead of spreading so thin and trying to embrace everything that society throws at us, the best thing for us would be to define the key elements that could make us good designers, and to teach those key elements.
Well, that's one proposal, but I do think, because I love your say the dilemma of the systematic dilemma, as you call it, so many topics outside that comes in, how to treat it. We can also be systematic about that. That's the inverse of your proposal. If we dedicate, and that's why the word everything was urbanism was a funny one. Everything is politics, everything is ethics, everything is... So I can see here a list of, say, 4 weeks programs where everything is at that moment for 3 weeks only dedicated to that. Make the project out of that, to turn it into a pamphlet, and then go on. So that's the inverse of your proposal.
Yeah, but I remember but when the I started remains here where in Delft, in the, civil engineering, actually, I have to confess, the first months, I was wrong. I came to the Faculty of Architecture.
You saw the light, the
yeah,
true light.
I thought it was much nicer than the neighbor. We were still the neighbors then. But I remember having to follow a course by Leo Fretz about... philosophical explanation of ethics. So I do agree with Rienz that it's good to have in the studios to have the discussions on politics and ethics, but it's also good that we teach what is the difference between morale and ethics, and what is ethics exactly, and that it doesn't become sort of an opinion thing, but that is something more fundamental. So adding it as a sort of in your basispakket, zeg maar, yeah, in yeah. your base package, wouldn't be such a bad idea.
Wouldn't it be nice if the
exactly
university
to prevent
would
it from becoming an opinion thing.
The entire university would have one course that everybody could go to.
But we have even more. We have the Delft Design for Values
yeah,
Institute.
There is a lot.
Which yeah. has, yeah. which includes 5 faculties already. And the question, because I think your question started, and it was a really good question, somewhere else. The AV is changing security perceptions and practices. Security has always been an architectural theme. So rather than bringing it down to the word of ethics, which makes it complicated and abstract, and it's the other thing out there, just talk about the values that are already in there. How does the architecture deal with security? And what does it mean if you install whatever, if you make a glass building or if you open the doors? Those are the questions that are inherently ethical within architecture, and those need to be spelled out and discussed with the students. And that's exactly, for me, the process moment where you come in. And then everybody can make their decision, but at least you're aware of what it means to close that door or close that door, to orient yourself to the city or not, to have this building or that building accessible, and you name it. And you could do the same with all the other issues of values, even ones that you mentioned before.
Is that your new course next year? I love it. Values in that way too.
I give the intro lecture on this. Come on.
Look at Anna. Yeah. Anna, I think value is the final topic. Do you want to have also the final say?
I would like to say that I really appreciate the debate. It could be more. Confronting, I think. Yeah. We were still very diplomatic.
We have to get used to it. Eh? It's the first debate.
Yeah, but I think it's very good, and maybe next time also the students can engage on the debate more, because in the end they are the future generation. So I think that also things we fight and question, that for them is really the logic, and that we should do it. And I think that they are pushing as well this change and this innovation towards the future. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. I think that's indeed a good final contribution. We've come to the end of the evening. Well, Javier, thank you very much for organizing this. And I think this is really what we set out to achieve, BK Talks and debates. I think it's only the beginning. For me, this is more like making an agenda for the debates that will follow. So I all invite you to join the next debates. I want to thank you all for your wonderful contributions, and the audience as well. Javier, the real final word is to you.
Thank you very much to you, the guest, and the audience here and at home, for making tonight Everything is Talks. So see you on November 12th. We will talk about heritage. Thanks a lot.